Okay, thank you very much for the introduction. Thank you very much for inviting me here. It's a pleasure to be here and to see you all. I don't know really much about your background, and that's why I will also give a little bit of motivation. So if I'm going too slow and then repeat too many things, please tell me. Then I can also just switch to the next slides and get to some more interesting parts. What I would like to talk about in this presentation here is related to a project that we're trying to set up at the University of Helsinki. So this is language technology in the Department of Digital Humanities, and we got some funding for a project that has exactly the same title as this talk here, Found in Translation. And as the title also says in the subtitle, this is about natural language understanding. Quite big words, so we would really like to understand languages as humans do. And our twist to this idea is that we want to use what I call cross-lingual grounding. So I will come back to that, to this idea about cross-lingual grounding in a minute, but before, and I don't know if I have to do this, I would like to still have a little bit of motivation how language technology is connected to artificial intelligence. Sometimes this is maybe not exactly clear what language technology, what is the position of language technology. And I would say that, so from my point of view, of course, the main part of language technology is that we want to use human languages and try to build computational models that can handle these languages. And there's two parts, basically, understanding and speaking or generating languages. And then the middle part would be the understanding part, so mapping some input to human languages into the meaning representation at some point. Having this kind of visualization, this really summarizes what language technology is all about. We are all about trying to model in the best possible way what we can do with human languages as an input, trying to get the essence of this input, this understanding part that humans perform very well. On the other side, we would also like to produce languages. So we want to produce and speak in the same way as people speak. So with this picture here and saying that this is really representing language technology, I would really claim that language technology is at the core of artificial intelligence. Communication between humans is really a major factor in what we call intelligence. Without communication, without language, there's really not the entire intelligence that we have achieved as a human, as human beings. So all kinds of things that are related to communication and understanding can come to some applications as well, but they really relate to many of the topics that you're familiar with. So if this is human-computer interaction or any other kind of communication, if there's interactive systems that you can interact with, if there's some kind of knowledge aggregation through the channels of languages, then this is really part of what we want to do. So with this motivation and also the background that we are actually sitting in the Faculty of Arts and maybe are not that visible as a research team working on artificial intelligence, this gives you the background that you might also want to look at this part in the center campus of the University of Helsinki. I will give you some links later also to our website, so if you want to know more about what we are doing and who's part of our team, then please look at those websites. And of course, you can ask questions. So, looking now at my topic here, also the same picture here, I motivate also with the same picture, usually the topic of machine translation, which then really integrates most of these parts that I'm talking about, because this really tries to do many of these components that we need to address if we want to look at understanding and speaking. Because if we just in this kind of triangle here now put the source language on one side and the target language on the other side, then we have the case of a machine translation or automatic translation that these computational models should perform on the basis of input from human languages and the output of human languages. So here also from my point of view, if I work on machine translation, this really makes a good summary of the different topics that language technology focuses on. So this is a lot about the kind of background motivation. Now, looking at some more details, because now we have the wave of deep learning and language technology is really much, of course, also affected by this. You have heard, and I guess that many of you have some background already also in language processing. One of the basic ideas is now that we want to have some kind of learning algorithm. So machine learning really is one of the key methodology here. So the idea is, of course, to use some data, experience that we can get from the data, and to see if a learning algorithm then, for example, can train some kind of neural network and in a common way In the most common way, we have some setup, an architecture that involves an encoder-decoder model or sequence-to-sequence model, as in the introduction was mentioned already. So here, in relation to the illustration that I had from the beginning, the understanding part and the speaking part, encoder somehow tries to approach or approximate this understanding part, and the decoder then the speaking part or the generation part, and in the middle is the model that tries to perform these different tasks. And as you know, we have now neural networks that try to map this into some kind of representation, but it doesn't have to be a neural network. Any kind of model would have some representation in the middle if you have this two-step procedure, for example. So you would like to represent the information that you get in some way. And in this particular part, of course, you get these kind of vector-based representations that we are all familiar with. So now this is now also marked in red, for the reason also because this is the main interesting part that we want to look at. So what kind of representations can we get? What is the thing that really is learned by a system? And here in this project that I'm trying to present here and then advertise, our main idea is that we want to go from mapping between just two languages, a source and target language. Instead, we want to go much broader. And probably in the presentation that you've heard in May, if you have been here, so the idea of having multilingual models has been proposed some time ago. And the idea is now that we can have some kind of model that can integrate many languages, not only two. I come also back to why this is an advantage for our representation learning idea here. So the idea is, of course, that if you have, for example, a mapping between two languages, there can be quite a lot of shortcuts that a system can take, meaning that we don't really have to understand completely. Just assume an example that you want to translate between related languages like English and French. Maybe it's not really necessary that you all understand the complete meaning and essence behind the message, because many things are quite literal translations, so you can really map without understanding. But if you assume that you have very diverse material, lots of languages involved, you hope that then you would guess that the system or also a human being would have to really make some deep understanding to generate a corresponding output. So, what the idea is that so we want to study what happens if we have some kind of single model that can handle many languages. So one single model can be different kinds of things. There can be different components that are reused, or it can be just one model that handles everything. But there will be some shared parameters or shared training procedures. And in this way, there's an objective of pushing the model towards some representation that goes beyond just mapping between two languages, but instead mapping language to some internal representation that is more or less language independent. So we'll have shared parameters, which is one of these most important components that we will look at. And the intuition behind having single models is then also, exactly as I said, if we cannot make these shortcuts, being very close to the surface, meaning that we don't really have to go far towards meaning representations, if we have massively parallel corpora, so massively different kinds of languages that we want to represent, then the model is really enforced to make much stronger abstractions. It has to do these kind of abstractions on a semantic level to get the meaning across. So this is the entire motivation that we have here. We are not really that much interested in the translation itself, but we are more interested in this learning process. Do we get this kind of really push into towards meaning representations by involving so many more difficult tasks for the model to learn? And this is now then related to the grounding effect that I tried to mention. So instead of grounding language to, for example, images or audio and so on, we take different translations as the proxy for denoting what we are talking about. Because languages talk about things and concepts in different ways. So in this way, we also get some kind of other kind of representation in the other languages, and we can use that as a supervision effect, saying that this is grounded in these other languages, and we hope that with this we can get closer to some meaning representations. So this leads to the project that we try to set up, or we have started actually. So we now want to look at how far can we get with this kind of model. What can we learn? What emerges from the data? What does the structure that we learn, does it really represent something that goes close to semantics? As I said, we are setting up this, so I cannot really present a lot of very impressive results, but we have some pilot studies which are already quite interesting. So just a bit more about this kind of setup and framework. The idea is, of course, also making it more natural to represent languages not as discrete units, but instead putting them into this continuous space as they are naturally. Because languages are not independent of each other. They are, in our environment, in some kind of continuous space. And this is typically not used if you just separate them into different models. So if you have language models and you create language models for different languages, you create discrete models, so you treat them as discrete units. Instead, it is much more natural to say that there's this continuum of languages. There's a lot of contact between them. We should also reuse or make use of the transfer between those different representations. So many things will be related to some vector space representations to reflect this kind of continuous representations. And we will, in the project, we will look at these three things that are here below. Let's see if I press the right button. Uh-huh. I never used it. I can't handle this. Multilingual machine translation is one of the things that we try to still look at, even though I said machine translation is not that important for us. But we need to evaluate somehow how well does the system really perform in doing this task. So one of the extrinsic evaluations that we try to run is, if we have a good semantic representation for some internal representations, then we can also use that really for mapping between languages. And if this is improved across maybe smaller languages or also these kind of this kind of zero-shot learning where you have not the training data represented for that language pair. If you can do that with this model better than with other models, then we can show that our semantic abstraction is better. So multilingual machine translation for us is an evaluation criterion, which we will use also in one of the sub-projects. Another thing is also more extrinsic evaluation is the semantic reasoning part. So if we assume that we now can map with these multilingual models any kind of input to some semantic representation in the middle, can we use that representation to do some logical reasoning like humans do? We can have entailment relations, for example, or contradictions, or I will give you some examples from paraphrasing later on. So if this now improves with these multilingual models, we can show that we have done the right thing. Then, of course, the last point here is then to also look really at the structures. So what are these representations that we learn here? And here, this is still and quite an open question to me, how we will analyze what kind of structural representations do we get, what kind of space representations do we get, what does it mean to have these kind of interlingual semantics. So here, there's a lot of open questions on how to analyze these representations. So this is our main setup. Now looking at some details here. Here is something that just tries to illustrate the typical encoder-decoder model, which is not completely correct here. It's really a simplification of this typical attention-based sequence-to-sequence model that people apply for machine translation. We have some input sequence that is first mapped into some word embeddings, and then we have bidirectional RNN, for example, in this case here. There's certain dimensionality to all these different parts. There's an attention mechanism, and here this is not really correctly reflected in this illustration, but just for illustration, we have now the connection between the encoder and the decoder by mapping this with some attention mechanism that can focus on different areas of the input, for example. So if this is our standard setup, a typical sequence-to-sequence model with attention that is used for many, many purposes, but also for machine translation, we can now think of having this as our basic framework for the first tests of doing some multilingual machine translation. And there has been a very simple method has been proposed, and we have also done something similar for language modeling ourselves before, where we can just inform the system about the different languages by just indicating the language that, for example, in this case, the language that it should produce in the output. So there can be language flags that we just add to the input, saying that now we read English and we want to produce German, for example. And this kind of information can be, through the attention mechanism, can be put into all parts of the output, for example, and can force the system to use or influences the parameter in such a way that now the system is doing exactly what we want to, for example, translating into German or into English or into French. So the idea is now that the system can pick up that information, reuses that and produces, can combine all these shared parameters in such a way that it can do different tasks. It basically triggers the different tasks that we have translating into different languages, for example. So the beauty of this is that this is really simplistic, very simple. So we can use that basically out of the box, train the same system, and now, for example, take our example of the Bible corpus that we have used here with about 960 translations that we have used, or languages that we have, not translations, but really languages, and try to train a combined model for the whole system, for the whole translation part here. So what this means is that now the system has the task to get all the information represented by that network here. So we have a network that really has to capture all the information. And as typical, what you have to do in machine learning, you have to compress information. You have to really make a compressed representation. And in this case, you have a very complex task, many, many things that you have to learn, translating between all these languages, English to all these languages in both directions. So it really has to make it has a really hard job in finding the best compression. And this is only done, only possible for the model by reusing a lot of parameters. So it really has to learn that we can reuse parameters for many, many purposes, for many, many languages. And this is exactly what we want, because now we know that the system is forced to make the best out of the capacity that the model has. It is really forced to find out what languages are very close to each other. So below you can see that these language flags are basically then mapped into some language embeddings or representations, which represent the closeness of the languages, because that triggers the information that can be reused by the system. So for us, not really interesting is the translation performance here. And if I would show some blur scores now, that would be really ridiculous. They'd be pretty low because the capacity of the model is not good enough for handling all these 900 languages. But instead, we are looking, for example, at this vector space that has been created for language embeddings. And I'll just give you a few pictures on how this develops. Now, batch is a bit misleading. I have run different subsets. And I've just trained the system in different kinds of batches of quite a large number of data sets. So this is now just giving you examples from in the European languages. And this is just at the beginning. So it's quite confusing here. As you can see, there's not much that makes sense. It's just a big mess. Of course, this is now mapped onto two dimensions from the 256 that we have. The only maybe interesting or funny part is here, we can see that English is an outlier language, as we all know. English is not a typical language for anything. That seems to be already recognized in the beginning. Well, it turns out that after some iterations, we can see that the whole thing moves and the system really learns to cluster languages according to some relatedness, similarity that we have. So here we can already see that after a few batches, we can see that these color-coded languages trying to move together in such a way that we would expect them, to some extent at least. Nothing is really perfect here, but it's really nice to see that the system really picks up and tries to organize the whole language space in such a way that it makes possible to compress the whole information in some better way. So if we do this further and further, we can see that something is happening. Of course, this really doesn't show much, but you can see that really clusters appear and emerge. And that is really interesting as the first kind of output here. And if we now do this for these 972 languages that I had in one of the runs that I tested, then we can see just by color coding here, for example, some language families that have a good representation in the data set, we can see that really the system tries to cluster these language families. And this for me is really amazing because there's no information about language families in the system. It only has these language flags and it tries to optimize things And here, from linguistic point of view, or if you would work on language typology, this kind of is already interesting. What can be picked up by the data without having expert knowledge about these different families, for example? It is still quite mixed, as you can see. So there's a lot of these kind of regions where there's not a clear-cut cluster. But this really, I think for me, is really motivating and encouraging to go further. Okay. I'm not really sure how much time I still have left, but let's go to natural language understanding. No time. Okay. I didn't really say much about natural language understanding, but one more recent experiment, or that's one of the main things that we try to do, is to really get this kind of abstraction that we can get by putting things together, not having single individual models, but having one model to combine everything. So we wanted to test that and do also a similar approach, having different languages involved, also from the Bible data set here. So we take English to X and X to English to train multilingual models. And then we start with English-French. First, only one single French translation of the Bible. The second setting would be to have several different kinds of French translations. And the last setting would be to add even more auxiliary languages. But the test that we want to do is we want to see if the model can recognize paraphrases between English texts, so from English to English. So how much does it help to have other languages involved in the system? So the system is the same, we create a multilingual model, but now we use that multilingual model as a paraphrase model. So it's really a model that we try to see how well does that represent paraphrasing. I will be quick on that. So here, this is a test set, so we need to test that. So now we have this kind of model. We have models of different kinds. And we want to see how well does it score on paraphrases where we know that these are paraphrases. So this is taken from an online resource. It's not completely perfect, but we can use it as having paraphrased sentences. And now we want to see what different models, what kind of perplexity do they have? How much are they surprised by seeing these examples? They're very much really reformulated things. And we can see that, so this is now the result page, just flipping through this. If we have a supervised model that is really trained on English-English, we have this red line below, so the lowest perplexity is some kind of upper bound. If we now have one model that only uses one single French Bible translation, but still the whole English data set, we have quite a big increase of perplexity. If you now just use all the French Bible translations, the English text is still exactly the same. We don't see more English data in training. But just having this diversity in the model pushes the perplexity of the model in this English-to-English task down quite a lot. And then the next, of course, interesting thing is what happens if you add even more auxiliary languages. And the thing is not completely clear. Some languages don't really help. But in the majority of cases, we can really see a perplexity reduction while doing this kind of thing. And again, this is again a very encouraging result, showing that we have this abstraction goes up because we test on something that the system is not trained for. Okay, I skipped these translation scores because they're maybe not that important, but I can come back to them if you want to. But just coming back to advertisement of the project, so this is what I'm showing to the funding people. So we want to achieve something that really can handle multilingual machine translation as our minimal goal. But we want to especially look at learning and interpreting semantic sentence representations. Really, representation learning is one of the most important things that we want to look at. But especially, we want to really have this kind of abstract continuous meaning space over all these languages, some kind of language independent space, and try to approach something that goes in the direction of human-like understanding of languages. So this is what we want to do. And with this, again, thank you for your attention. And I'm open for questions and comments. Thank you.
Representations develop in the middle. They are vectors. What do you think? What's the limitation that this poses? Or do you think that it's a limitation? And if so, how would you go through it or beyond it?
There's definitely limitations to that. I mean, first of all, it's not only a single vector. In this case, it would be a sequence of vectors. But But then again, we don't really know exactly how to use that. Maybe you want to map it again to just one vector representation. That's one practical question. I think that we need to go beyond just sequences as well. There's more structure that we want to detect. I'm not exactly sure how that will look like. I don't have really good answers on how to tackle that problem, but we probably have to look at some other architectures where, for example, the interplay between attention and sequence representations, for example, can also give rise to emerging hierarchical structures, for example. Those kind of questions. But I have no better idea than to map to kind of vectorial representations at the moment, if that's also something that you wanted to ask, if there's some other kind of representation that we can think of. But I'm open for suggestions, let's say.
One detailed question was that, are you using word embeddings or are you going on a character level or how you are going to do about that?
So in these experiments, we used subword units. Mm-hmm. So they were automatically segmented just by on statistical basis. This is necessary to also get the statistics that you need, but also necessary to fit things into memory. So you have memory limitations that we have to fulfill, especially with these models at 900 languages, then you have rather small units. So it almost goes to character level, yes. So in the end, for some languages, I think it's basically character level. For some other languages where we have more representative units, we would have subword levels and some complete words as the first like embedding stage.
So it would be different for different languages?
No, so the whole data set was segmented automatically in as one data set, but it turns out that then these segments are different in different languages depending on the distributions that you see.
Makes sense.
Yeah. Character level is in general is very interesting. The problem is that the sequence get very long and then there's a problem of training with still limited training data, for example. There I also see that we need to go to some other architectures where different segmentation levels should be combined to get some information that really connects these different parts. There goes the question.
You know, this is perhaps more a philosophical question also to all the audience. I was just recently came across with an article from MIT professors claiming that we actually would need a new discipline to understand machine behavior. So in a broader sense, what you're experiencing now, do you actually exactly know and understand what's happening?
Philosophical questions are difficult to answer, of course, but so let's see, the whole thing here is of course based on the training data. So we only learn what we experience. And so far, in this setup at least, the experience that the system gets is the training data. So it doesn't really make communication and tries to negotiate social behavior from machine to machine in this setup at least. But of course, that could be an extension to say that you also want to have agents that talk to each other and develop their own languages. There's also these approaches that they also can have some other kind of reward that they get. Now, the only reward that we give here is translation accuracy. So you only train them to translate. And of course, with this, we really reset the objective. So I don't, in this particular point here, I don't see any ethical issues yet. But of course, that can it can happen that machines develop their own behavior by maybe developing this communication skill further. But that's not what we are modeling here yet. I guess that the whole field becomes more aware of these ethical questions, especially also in language technology, because this was typically before the case that everyone could easily recognize that now I'm talking to a human, now I'm talking to a machine, and this kind of border is now more blurry, and that can be already some issue that should be discussed.